every candidate must make an oath or affirmation. Oath is always in the name of God, and affirmation, somebody may not like to take the oath. If you say, I solemnly affirm. So every candidate has to make an oath or affirmation, and for that if a particular form is prescribed in the constitution itself. If we see the third schedule to the constitution, there are several forms of oath prescribed for judges of the Supreme Court, for other dignitaries, and then there are two forms prescribed for oath by the candidate. One by the candidate before he contests the election, at the time of the contesting election. Another for that candidate who wins and wants to take a seat in the house. But we are concerned here only with the oath which he has to take as a candidate. And for that there are forms 3A and 7A. 3A is for Lok Sabha, 7A is for the assemblies in that particular schedule. And those forms you have to keep sufficiently, in sufficient quantity, printed in advance, because the candidates will come to you. You have to administer the oath to them. So you have to be ready with those forms. And though the form is smaller, but we, from our the election commission side, we have added something at the bottom to show when he made the oath, before whom he made the oath. That particular revised format is given in the returning officer's handbook. So you, the, I think they are all centrally printed, and the chief electoral officer will give you. So that form has to be filled by the candidate. And there are two, three requirements for that particular oath. Firstly, the oath has to be read out by the man. He cannot simply just sign and then give it to you, because the law says shall make and subscribe. They have said make means he has to read out, and then subscribe means he has to put his signature. And supposing somebody is illiterate, then in that case you will have to tell him that I am reading out, you just follow me and you repeat those things. Otherwise it's not the administration. In the administration of the oath, somebody first reads it out and the other repeats it, in the case of this chief minister or ministers or so. But here they say makes, he himself has to read out and then make, subscribe. So you will be giving him that form, he will read out and then he will put his signature, and then below that you will have to sign. Yes, he signed, he made this oath in my presence at this time and at this hour. Because here also, this time and date is very important for two reasons, I will tell you. The purpose is that somebody must say that I am going to be a candidate, and if elected, I will uphold the sovereignty, unity, integrity of the country, and I will uphold the principles of secularism, democracy. So that is the purpose, and so a form is prescribed. Then this oath can be taken before whom? The Article 84 and 173 itself says shall be made before such officer or such person whom the election commission authorizes. So we have given an authorization. If you find, if you see the returning officer's handbook, in that there is a complete order which was issued way back in 1968, and it's still continuing. In that particular order we have said that the first person before whom the oath can be made is the returning officer of the constituency, and here before the ARO also. And here we are not saying the only that ARO who has been authorized. Here all AROs, we have said, if there are three AROs, before anyone he can go, and then he can make and subscribe that oath. Then of course magistrates and the judicial officers. Then there may be a situation where a person may be confined in a prison. He may be undergoing some imprisonment, or may be under trial prisoner, and he wants to contest. So he can take the oath before the superintendent of the jail, in which case we have given the instructions to the superintendents that as soon as the oath is made before him, he has to give a written, or now of course email and all those things are very easy. So he can immediately give you a intimation through email, fax or anything that this man who is confined in my prison, he has made the oath at this time and this hour. And then it will be the responsibility of the candidate to present that particular form in original before the RO. But at the same time, the superintendent must also help him. Supposing the superintendent does not help him and then does not allow anybody to go to the prison and he can't even hand over that form to anybody. So our instructions to the superintendents of jails are there that you extend every help. And sometimes we have found, even in the last election in Manipur, somebody contested election from Tihar jail in Delhi. In Manipur he contested. So we made arrangements for those oath forms to be sent to Manipur. This is one. Then thirdly, another situation where person may be under preventive detention. So there also the whosoever is the in charge of that detention camp, before him also the oath can be taken. Then fourth, there may be where a person may be confined in a hospital, maybe undergoing some treatment, or maybe undergoing treatment in his own house, and some medical practitioner may be attending on him. So we have authorized them also. So they can also administer the oath, or before them also the oath can be taken, but the original form they have to produce before you at the time of scrutiny. Then sometimes it may so happen that a person may be outside. He may not be available in India on the date of the nominations. So we have said that the diplomatic or the consular representative of India in that country can also is also the person before whom this oath can be taken. And of course, in case any person has any other difficulty, then if he comes to us, we can even nominate somebody to specially administer the oath to him. So these are the only persons before whom the oath can be made and subscribed. Now the next question will be, oath or affirmation when can be made? There previously there was some doubt, but now that doubt has been clarified by the Supreme Court in 2-3 judgments. The oath form, they have said, candidate nominated for so and so. The Supreme Court has then said, nominated means a person who has filed his nomination paper with the RO. A person may have been, say, proposed by some persons. He is keeping that nomination paper still in his pocket. He cannot come and say, no, you please allow me to take the oath. First, he has to give his nomination paper, and then he becomes a candidate nominated, and then he can take the oath. So the nomination, that is why another, I told you that you have to, on the nomination paper, you have to give the date and time, exact time. This is very relevant, because the oath can be 1 minute or say half a minute later than the presentation, but it can't be before the presentation. So that is very important. Once he has given the nomination paper to you, then he can make the oath, not earlier than that. Then the last date, he may not be immediately available, he may be sending his nomination paper through his proposer. So the oath can be made by him only before the commencement of the date of scrutiny. Commencement of the date means right up to the end of the day. So even up to 12 o'clock, supposing the scrutiny is to take place on a particular day, say 10th January. So up to 9th January, 12 o'clock in the night, he can make and subscribe the oath. That is the, but as soon as 10th January has started, the date of scrutiny has started, then he cannot take the oath. So these are the two termini. After he has presented the nomination paper to you, and before the date of scrutiny has commenced at the dead of that midnight, he has to take oath between those two periods. And then, of course, in one case, Supreme Court has also said that if a person is contesting from two constituencies, then if he has taken the oath in one and he satisfies the RO in the other one that I have taken the oath in the second constituency, he need not be asked to take the oath again. So, supposing he has given four nomination papers, it's not necessary that for every nomination paper he must make the oath again and again. So, one oath is enough for all the nomination papers. But supposing he is contesting election from Lok Sabha and also he is contesting election for assembly, then he has to make two oaths because the forms are also different. One he will make the oath as a Lok Sabha candidate, the other oath he will take as a assembly candidate. This I have already told you that he can't simply just sign and then give it to you. He has to read out and then sign. And normally in the case of the administration of oath, both are standing and then one man is reading. So in one case the RO was sitting and the candidate read out. Then some questioner was, no, no, this is not the oath. Because court said, no, it's not necessary that the RO should also stand up. He is sitting and he is reading out and signing. One thing we have also prescribed, that supposing the candidate is not there, he has sent his nomination through some proposer, and so he should not be taken by surprise saying that at the time of scrutiny you have not taken the oath, so we want you to give him a reminder. For that in the returning officer's handbook there is a letter prescribed, so you just keep those letters ready. As soon as somebody is there, you just fill the name and whosoever has come to give the nomination paper, you hand over a copy of that to him, say, so that tomorrow he may not say that I was not told. And this we gave because in one case we found that the candidates, all candidates except the candidate of one particular party, they were all kept in the dark that you have to take the oath. So on the date of scrutiny only one was accepted, all others were rejected, so they had become an uncontested election.